In Great Britain in mid-July, the leader of the opposition stood in the House of Commons and tore the Prime Minister and his Chancellor of the Exchequer limb from limb. The discussion was over concrete and recondite points of economic policy. And the next day, all of the papers and all of the journalists and commentators were whistling over the bravura performance. Margaret Thatcher had proved herself something of a polemical juggernaut. Although her election as party leader was done over 2 years before, and although she had skillfully led her party with perhaps one or two mistakes in tactics, she was now pronounced ready. The polls indeed show the Conservatives preferred over the reigning Labour Party by about 10 points. And the council elections of last May were a convulsive rejection of the Labour Party. Still, there are difficulties. Mrs. Thatcher, as most people know, grew up the daughter of a grocer. At college, she studied chemistry. At Oxford, she was practicing her After Oxford, she was practicing her trade as a research chemist when, unaccountably, she became interested in the law. So working during the day, caring for her two children, at night she studied law. In due course, she was elected to the House of Commons, replacing Mr. Edward Heath as leader in the winter of 1975. The theme of our discussion is supposed to be what have we learned from the failure of British socialism? Really, this is two subjects. The first being, what is there to be learned from the failure of British socialism? The second, what in fact has been learned from the failure of British socialism? In a recent speech, Mrs. Thatcher said, "We observe what happens elsewhere and draw lessons from it. But we are aware that different national traditions, experience, and religious values affect the total political and economic situation." Question: does the failure of British socialism have the same meaning for the United States as, say, for Venezuela?
I think you've got to recognize at the outset that, broadly speaking, there are two ways in which any government can proceed. One is a way based on what you and I would call a free society, which is enshrined right at the heart of the American Constitution. The other one is a way which allows only one view, both of economics and politics, in which almost everything is either owned or controlled by the state, including the media, including the ideas, including freedom of discussion and everything. There is no freedom of discussion. Now, between those two ways, the free society and the totally controlled society, there are, of course, variations. I think what we've learned in Britain is that we've gradually, over the last certainly 12 or 13 years, with perhaps a little interruption, gone slowly further and further away from the free society towards something else. At the same time, we've found, I don't find it strange, but some other people do, that we have stopped creating wealth. We've had a large number of increasing restrictions, and you've been finding two things. First, that we are more and more concentrating on redistributing the wealth we've got rather than creating any more. To create more, you need a slightly freer society and you need an incentive society. Naturally, when I see that happening, I look with very great alarm to societies which have gone even further left. That is, they've tried to redistribute even more and haven't had the incentives for people working hard on their own account, doing well for their families, and often then being able to create jobs for others. They've produced a much more prosperous society than we have. But by and large, you've got the two broad, different economic and political approaches.
Well, I'm as usual, interested in what you say, but I would like you to focus, if you will, on what is essentially a problem in epistemology. How do people learn? Now, for instance, the Prime Minister, Mr. Callaghan, who, by the way, Since we're here rather than in New York, I take it you feel a little bit freer to discuss the names of your our colleagues, right, and criticize
we'll
them.
We'll do our best.
Okay. Now, Mr.
I
Callahan,
know when I'm in New York, I don't like criticizing our leading members of government. I will criticize policies.
Let me digress there for just a moment. A while ago, the Archduke Otto von Habsburg told me that the tradition inside Europe had collapsed about staying away from each other's political affairs. He gave as evidence the fact that he had campaigned along with several Austrians for the German Christian Democrats in the last German elections, and that a whole delegation of people from the Labour Party had come in from Great Britain loudly advocating the election to Germans of the Socialists. Is that a new development?
Well, no, not quite. You see, there's always been a movement for international socialism, always, and the socialist parties have always had contact with other socialist parties, and of course, as you know, the communist parties have had contacts the world over, and we say that socialism is a way on the road to communism. So we've had an international socialism.
But they usually use indigenous people to do their work.
Well,
they usually don't send Englishmen to Germany to tell the Germans.
Well, we, for example, have in the Labour Party here, to which I don't belong, as you know, but I've seen leading politicians from other countries come to the Labour Party conference here. Now, on the whole, we who belong to the other side have never had that alliance with other like-minded parties throughout the world. Incidentally, in Europe, we're trying now to get it, just for that very reason. We say socialism tends to stand together throughout the world. We must have what I call the freer way of life, likewise standing together. Otherwise, we're in danger of becoming one-party states, one-party only in power. So I am also doing that. I went to the Christian Democrat Party conference in Hanover before the German elections, to talk to them about how we were feeling and the things we had in common. So we are getting together just in the same way as socialist internationals getting together.
Do you have to observe rather careful protocols when you do that? Not to mention the local good party.
Let me put it this way. If when I'm anywhere in the world, I am questioned, for example, if there's been a run on sterling and I've been questioned when I've got off the aeroplane about it, then I have said, look, there's a tradition in our country that the leader of the opposition never comments on sterling while overseas.
Especially after an airplane flight, because God knows what's happened during the interval, right?
Yes. Well, but you tend not to do anything which could damage the standing of sterling the world over.
Sure.
But the other thing is interesting, I agree, it is interesting, that like-minded parties are going across the world to say there are certain things we have in common. I believe you won't keep political freedom unless you also have economic freedom, which means that you must have a large part of free enterprise in your whole economy. If socialism is restricting that, then they're restricting freedom at the same time.
Right, but would you feel free to make the obvious linkages? I mean, would you feel...
Well, you just try, and I'll do my best.
No, but I mean, would you feel free, for instance, to campaign in Germany for the conservative candidate in a national election?
You've raised another point, either wittingly or unwittingly. The word conservative has a different meaning throughout the world, as you know.
All right, the libertarian candidate, then.
The libertarian candidate. Would I go across personally and campaign? No, but we are going to their party conferences, which you might say is a similar kind of thing. The party conference before the election campaign, I did go to and spoke at.
Right.
And they had a European morning in which all of the libertarian parties from the European countries went to Hanover in Germany that morning. I spoke on behalf of the libertarian parties in Britain, Mr. Tindemans from Belgium. And there was one representative from each and every European country speaking for the libertarian parties to that party conference in Germany.
I see. So the situation is permitting things that were excluded as recently as 5 years ago.
Yes, it is.
Okay. Now, to get back to this question of how people learn, in a recent, and if I may say so, very moving talk that you gave on Ian MacLeod, you quoted the Prime Minister of Great Britain, the Mr. Callahan, who said in 1960, I have not the slightest doubt that the economic measures and the socialist measures, which one will find in the countries of Eastern Europe, will become increasingly powerful against the uncoordinated, planless society in which the West is living at present. Now, we assume that since 1960, Mr. Callahan has learned something, right?
It would be impossible not to, I trust.
Oh, no. I think I know lots of people who haven't learned anything since 1960.
I hope they never come on your program.
Well, I wish some of them would. I don't think Mr. Brezhnev has learned a great deal since 1960.
But then, you see, they have no free play of ideas in that society. That's one of the points that I started with.
Well, no, Brezhnev is allowed to read. He has a secret library in which he can read the Reader's Digest.
Yes, indeed. But unless you have freedom of discussion over a whole society, you soon cease to have any new ideas. Don't you find that new ideas develop when you can talk about them with other people? If you can't discuss them freely because there is a correct view, you soon cease to have new ideas. Now, the interesting thing, I think, in the Soviet Union is that a good deal of the different views come from people who have to be trained to think in the scientific sphere, because Russia would never have had some of her achievements. After all, she did get up the first Sputnik, unless she'd trained people to think in the scientific sphere. Now, you can't train them to think in maths and science without having the power for thought and thinking new ideas spilling over. And it's interesting to me, you see, that a lot of your people who've been thinking new political thoughts, unwelcome to the regime, have often been those who've come from the scientific sphere.
I think that's true. But if we were sitting here alongside, say, Milton Friedman and the late Von Mises and Hayek, I think we could say to them, granted, much has happened since 1960, but not that which would have proved uniquely emancipating to Mr. Callahan. He should, by 1960, have known that the economics of Bulgaria and East Germany and Poland were not going to do much for the working man in Great Britain. But the fact of the matter is he has learned something. Now, my question to you is, can you assume that what Mr. Callahan has learned, given the fact that he is rather slow to learn, is something that he has learned at a greater speed than the electorate of Great Britain, or at a slower speed? Have the voters of Great Britain learned faster than he has? Or are they dependent on the progress of his own thought? I'm talking about his special constituency.
Oh dear, that's a very, very complicated question.
That's why I asked it, yeah.
Yeah, you have a way of finding the difficult ones. I think he has a difficulty, which I don't have. He has fundamentally a split party. I referred to that quotation in 1960. I went into the House of Commons in 1959, so I've been there 18 years. In 1959, you could count the number of extreme left-wingers in the Labour Party, certainly on two hands. There were perhaps seven or eight of them. We knew who they were. We all rather thought that this was just an example of the eccentricity of British politics, that it allowed that kind of thing.
The so-called Tribune
Group. Yes, and in a way was rather proud that this thing happened. Now, after the last election, there are more than 80 of them. So you see, you've gone from a situation in which you had a very few left-wingers in the Labour Party to one in which you've had over 80.
Well, now,
doesn't that argue against your thesis? I haven't even developed the thesis yet. He, therefore, has a totally split party behind him, and he relies on those 80 Tribune groupers, and they can always collect a few more, because there are some very near their views in the Labour Party, to see his policies through. Now, you know, you've travelled the world as I have. The one thing about left-wing politicians is they're always fanatical. They never let go. It's their religion. They go on and on. And although they are a minority of the Labour Party, about 80 to 100 out of some 300, they tend to dominate them in view. They tend to get their views through the Labour Party conference. And so whatever Mr. Callahan himself and some of the other democratic socialists who don't hold extremely left-wing views, but much more moderate ones. The fact is that the left-wing section of the Labour Party is gathering control and is always relentless in the pursuit of what it believes, and its objective is not to make capitalism in Britain flourishing and prosperous for the people, but to replace it with a totally socialist system. Now, ironically, and this is the end part of the argument I will put, it's the left wing that I think has led the policies of the Labour Party, and your Social Democrats have not really argued with them, although they've been in the majority. They've not been in the ascendancy. Indeed, one after another, they're leaving them. Look, Roy Jenkins, David Marquand, Mr. Walden from Ladywood, all Brown Walden. Excellent, real Social Democrats, in many ways differing very little from what quite a lot of my party believes. But they are leaving. They're not fighting. They are leaving. And Reg Prentice, as you know, resigned from the government, and people are fighting him in his constituency.
George Brown.
George Brown, in one of his recent broadcasts, I did a panorama broadcast. Mr. Callaghan did one last October. He himself said there are 20 or 30 extra constituencies where the extreme left wing are active. So even though Jim Callaghan may by nature be with the moderates, the fact is that the extreme left are active in the Labour Party and are moving left. Now, does that answer your thesis?
Well, it approaches it. I have no thesis. I really have a query. Mm-hmm. Which is, what is it that causes people to learn, assuming that
they are
right-minded? Well, experience, but experience.
Sometimes thought.
Actually, your explanation, yes, unfortunately, argues the opposite. You said in 1960 there were only 8 of these fanatics. Now their number has multiplied 1,000%, which is hardly an argument for epistemological optimism.
But when you say what causes people to learn, I was thinking in terms of the electorate. Clearly, you were thinking in terms of politicians. It comes to really asking...
There is a cultural lag there, isn't there?
It comes to really asking, why are people in politics? And I think in many ways American politics have been... Well, they are very different, because you've two parties based on a free society, mm-hmm, or free enterprise society and economic freedom. We've one party based on that, one main party, and another one based on socialism. But you see, for years now in British politics, this word, you must use it, consensus, has reared its head. You must have a consensus. It's a word, again, you used not to use when I first came in politics. We had convictions. And we tried to persuade people that our convictions were the right ones. And it's no earthly good having convictions unless you have the will to translate those convictions into action. But politics was more, if you had convictions, than a matter of multiple maneuverings to get through the problems of the day. I often think when you're going for consensus, so often it means that those who believe, as I believe, tend to give in to the left wing, and you steadily move further and further left. Now, I'm in politics because of conviction. But I know that the last election, the previous election, was fought in Britain on what I think is one of the most damning sentiments ever uttered. And it was by the predecessor to Mr. Callaghan, Harold Wilson. What the British people wanted, he said, was a bit of peace and quiet, anything for a quiet life. Now, you know and I know that this is the great drag on democracy, that people will say, does my voice count? Can I do anything? And therefore they leave it to a tiny, well-organized minority. Now you ask, have people learned? Yes, they are learning that if you do leave it to that tiny, well-organized minority...
Unpleasant things happen.
Unpleasant things happen, and you then recoil from that. Mm-hmm. In part, you expect your politicians to do something about it. The question is whether the people themselves will back up the politicians. I understand that one time you are perhaps interviewing Mr. Bukowski. I was very impressed with one of his speeches, which I think he made in the United States. I picked it up here because I thought it put it marvelously. Way back in Russia, where they had no freedom at all, and one or two like him were determined to fight for it, whatever it cost. The view he took was not, does my voice count? The view he took was, if not me, who? If not now, when? Now that's the view that I want each Democrat, and I use it in the ordinary sense of a believer in democracy, to take in Britain.
And I think that is correct. It is an ethical imperative of sorts, but it doesn't quite answer the question, what is it that ultimately transforms experience into guidance? I give you a recent example.
It's conviction and determination.
It's a hierarchy of values, isn't it? Because if by experience you find that you lose a certain amount of liberty,
yes,
in return for a precarious security,
yes, you decide
and you
what
don't,
matters
and you don't
to
mind,
you.
Then you don't.
Yeah, yeah, you call it a hierarchy of values. I say what matters to you, and if I lose liberty, then it takes away the basic reason for living.
So what is
if you're the sort of person who doesn't mind about having any liberty, provided you've got a house and food coming to you and you will do what you're told to do, then perhaps you won't mind. I suppose it's the difference between being born free and living life like an animal at the zoo in a cage.
Yeah.
All right, some animals do live lives in cages. But I mean, for me, freedom
is
part of life.
Don't
it's
vote.
All. Well, so I only use that as an example to show that the difference between you can have total security without any freedom.
Sure. But now, I was about
to some people, that would be attractive, not to me at all.
I was about to give you an example of something recently written by an eminent professor of economics called George Stigler, the University of Chicago. And he said, you know, there are a few things that economists know with the force of certitude. There are a huge number of things about which we are very vain that we don't know at all. But certain things we do know. And one of them, for instance, is that minimum wages will not raise the level of income. Now, he said, any further demonstration of this is entirely supererogatory. It's just known. However, neither the Republican Party in America nor the Democratic Party would ever dare to come out in opposition to the minimum wage, because the superstition is endemic that the minimum wage actually elevates the income of poorer people. In fact, poorer people are precisely who are hurt by a minimum income. Now, in the British experience with socialism, there must be counterparts to the minimum wage, things that, as you pointed out in that heated exchange last week, on which I congratulate you, by the way, with the Prime Minister citing all of his predictions over a period of 4 or 5 years, each one of which turned out to be wrong. Question, what is it that people learn from this experience, or is there something that prevents them from learning in the light of the depreciated value of human freedom?
I think there are two things. Well, there's an awful lot in what you said, and I'll just try to remember it all. But you can learn quite a lot from experience. That's one thing. There's something after that. Have you the will and determination to do anything about it?
Why should you not have?
Well, I'm afraid some people don't.
I mean, just the lack of the exertion
risk? The exertion. They would prefer to take the easy way. The hard way is tough, by definition.
Yeah, yeah.
Many people would prefer to have it easier. Anything for a quiet life.
Yeah.
What the British people want is a bit of peace and quiet. Others of us know we can rise to higher and better things than that and believe that's part of our purpose in life. So there are two things. One, you recognize what is happening. Two, are you prepared to do anything about it? Now, you make the point about minimum income. I think in societies where there are enormous differences between very great wealth and very great poverty, I would recoil from that.
Recoil from what?
from enormous differences between very great wealth in the presence of very great poverty.
But that has nothing to do with minimum wage.
Yes, but it has. One moment.
What?
You wait, I'm coming to that. So, there is therefore something to be said for a certain amount of redistribution there from, by taxation, and you've done it as well as we have, this is what taxation is about. So you do a certain amount of redistribution from those, yes, I know you're getting very irritated, but just wait one moment. from those to try to help people who are poverty-stricken to get up off the floor and raise their standard. And we would call that not a minimum wage,
yeah.
We would call that a basic safety net. And we would accept a moral commitment in a kind of society like yours or ours that jointly we do try to guarantee some basic standard of life, and indeed rather more than a basic standard of life. But there are certain benefits you can get from Social Security, and we both agree on that. Now, what has happened to us is that the redistribution process has gone on so much further that the standards here, say in earnings, are our lowest income earners earn about half average earnings, and our top in net take home pay, our top income earners only earn about four times. So that's a comparatively narrow gap. As a matter of fact, it happens to be narrow, isn't it, in Soviet Russia. Now, once you compress the incentives from the top down and say, it doesn't matter how much you earn, I'm going to take the lion's share away from you, then they say, all right, I'm no longer going to do the lion's part. And then they stop creating the extra wealth, which would both benefit them and benefit society as a whole. Once they stop doing that, they don't benefit, then there aren't any extra taxes to improve the schools or the social services. Now, do you see, there is some point in some societies in a degree of redistribution, but once it becomes a depression on incentive to get on by your own effort, then you're denying all people the means of increasing the wealth of our people individually and as a whole.
Sure.
And you just become, as we have become,
you're making the
a stagnant
point of, that's
right. society.
You're making the point of counterproductivity. After
I'm
all,
sure it you'll have a piece of jargon for it.
Well, counterproductive, I don't think that's just an Americanism, is it?
Well,
I think they use the term in Great Britain. It means that
yes.
you try to do one thing, but the opposite happens.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. Indeed, yes, it is.
And so redistribution pressed beyond a certain point actually
yes.
hurts the people who are designed to be to
indeed,
benefit.
Yes, yes.
That the point, what you have done
it's
is to made you've made a pragmatic a demonstration. But it's not one that exactly touched on a slightly different point made by Professor Stigler.
I'm sorry, let's get back to Professor Stigler.
Well, Professor Stigler's point is that that you cannot effectively increase the wages of the poorest people in a society by fiat.
Exactly.
What you do is cause unemployment.
I did, with respect, touch on it, because I said once you stop those people in society who are capable of creating wealth, who can start up a business from nothing, mm-hmm. build up a big business, yes, they benefit themselves, but look at the number of people they employ. Once you stop those wealth creators from creating the wealth, then there's nothing extra to distribute. And once society has just become a means, economically, of shuffling round the shekels you've got, mm-hmm. rather like passing the parcel,
becomes
who
sort of
gets
fetid.
It, then your society as a whole doesn't gain.
Yeah.
I have touched on it. You've got to keep the incentives going at the top. And I don't care where the top comes from. I'm not concerned. This is one of the great things that has always attracted me about American society, and now attracts me about the kind of political faith I have. I couldn't care two hoots where a person comes from. With their background, we try to give them a better and better background insofar as the state can. What I care about is what they've got to contribute to society. And we so fix the tax laws and the other laws that they can make that contribution, because the increasing wealth will only come from them. It won't come by government diktat. And it can't come, I agree with your professor, by shuffling round the shekels among your people. So we're agreeing. Now, what's the next one?
I'm not sure, really, that you're disagreeing with Mr. Healy. Mr. Healy said a year and a half ago, look, This is presumably...
I'm disagreeing with what he does.
Yeah. But in a fit of exasperation, he said in the House, look, goddammit, if we take... Can you say goddammit in the House? You probably can't, can you?
I don't know, but I wouldn't mind having a shot.
He said, if you take 100% of the salary of everybody who makes, I use American terms, if I made $12,000 a year, you would raise enough to pay the costs of 1.5%.
Oh, but you'll soon have no one over $12,000 a year.
Which is 4.5 days. What's that?
You'll soon have no one over $12,000 a year.
One time.
The revenue next time will
correct.
Be nil.
So it seems that he is learning from experience.
Oh, but you know, from some things, from what they say, they're really very good. I mean, he pointed out in 1976, I went through the quotes thoroughly before the debate, that your middle management, for example, had a really raw deal here. They haven't had any increases to speak of for 2 years, and they've taken all of the brunt of inflation. And he said that he had great sympathy with them, but sympathy is not enough from a chancellor. What he wanted to do was to release the tax on that group, because it's so much on that group that you depend on getting your human relations right in a factory.
Yeah.
So there are some things which he says are very good, but never forget that group of left-wingers standing behind him.
Who have some sort of guillotine.
Who don't want an incentive society. Mm-hmm. They just want a redistributive one.
Speaking of nefarious groups, I am told, and I wish you'd confirm or correct this, that a considerable element of the business community in Great Britain is pro-labor, not because its sympathies are pro-labor, but because it reasons that, above all, Great Britain needs stability, and that if you came to power, you'd be in there for a year or two, and then there would be a convulsion, and then the other people would take over. And in the course of the gyrations, it would be impossible to make any long-term strategic plans. Now, as both of us know, morality is by no means a dominant consideration in much of the capitalist class.
I will argue that with you. There are some people in any group who let down the morality. Can I just argue that point before we go to the other?
Sure.
I have been arguing, and I think I rather saw some of the speeches that I'd been making on one of your files there, that capitalism has a moral basis. The reason being that unless you have economic freedom, you will have no other freedom at all.
Yeah.
So the whole of the capitalist society is a moral basis. The basis is that the individual is here to develop his or her talents. He cannot do that without both political freedom and economic freedom. The only kind of society under which you can do that is a capitalist society. To be free, you have to be capitalist. Every free society in the world is a capitalist society. Now, not every capitalist society is free, but
yes, that's
a precondition of freedom is capitalism.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So it has a moral basis.
Yep.
Now, certainly, if you have freedom, you have freedom to do good or freedom to do evil. Mm-hmm. So obviously, it's the essence of choice. I remember one of your presidents in a speech which I very well remember reading. He said, power to do good is inseparable from power to do evil. That's, I'm afraid, inherent in choice. Some people use it well, some people abuse it, but it's the basis of the free society. So that's the moral part. Now, what was the other part that we were on?
I'll give you, since you're collecting presidential aphorisms, Jefferson,
yes.
A government can only do something for the people in proportion as it can do something to the people.
Yes.
Which makes the same
yes,
point.
Yes, it does, it does, level. Beautifully yeah. does. But there was another question you asked me just before you slipped in the moral bit, and I've almost forgotten what it was.
Do your
young audience know?
The question of the moral, of the moral.
Oh, the city.
Mentioned.
The British
are conservatives.
And we might
business.
I remember business. You said that they might, though they're not labor by conviction. Of course, they can't be because capitalism is essential to them to be able to carry on their creative talent.
Well, not necessarily.
Now, they can
get special privileges, can't they?
Well, some of them.
Special protections from government.
Well, you mean that they could become chairman of nationalized industries?
Well, if you were director of British Leyland, you might very well be pro-socialist, right, rather than pro-Thatcher.
Well, maybe. maybe, but that's not capitalist. That's become government.
I know, but it's thought of as industry, isn't it?
Or thought of as industry. Yeah. Can I deal with the point, because it's one that frequently comes up. Look, if you get a Tory government, then you'll get industrial unrest. The unions won't work with you. Point number one, the unions aren't exactly cooperating with the government now on the next phase of incomes policy, because it doesn't matter who you are, you can't escape economic reality.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, some of them, I think, have got out of, some of the union leaders have got out of step with some of their members. And it's inevitable. If union leaders start cooperating too much with the government in power, they will do so at the cost of some of the interests of their members. You look at some of George Meany's speeches. He would never do it because he said it will lose us our freedom, it will lose us our bargaining capacity. And what has happened is that we all naturally wanted those people who are least well off to do better. But what the unions didn't realize was that you'd have a redistribution between the skilled, from the skilled to the unskilled, and your skilled have done very badly. So they are now.
So there are massive defections there.
That's right, and this is what would be one of the factors which has led us to win so many by-elections. But I think the most telling thing is we've been doing what I would call a trawl of quotations from the Labour government. Of the nearest similar one would be the one which came into power just after the war. I know some people think it's a long time ago, but after all, in wartime, you'd had 6 years of a controlled society, then we had socialism for another 6 years, and people just had this same feeling, oh, dare we make a dash for freedom? Wouldn't it be better to be safe? I've done a trawl of quotations. They have said, if you let a Tory government in, you'll have industrial unrest, you'll have a miners' strike, you'll have civil strife, you'll have all sorts of things. Now, we got in 1951, and we were in for 13 years. We had no worse time with industrial relations than the Labour government had had. And those 13 years were the only real 13 years this country's had of rising prosperity. Because we knew we had to put the emphasis back onto the incentive society. Walter Monckton was the first Minister of Labour. And after all, we know that in an ordinary election, at least one third of the members of trade unions vote Conservative. We believe that now a far bigger proportion of that is doing so. So I discount this view, and I think you'll find that when the chips are down, is that an expression you use?
Yeah.
When we have an election.
Got it good.
when the chips are down, they'll come along and they'll be supporting me, because the best ones can always use the greater freedom and want to, for the advantage of the people who work for them. And we also want to use it for the advantage of British society as a whole. We've a lot more to contribute to the world than we're contributing at present, you know. We really have.
We're a lot better
than our present performance.
Yes. Incidentally, in a recent book on the failures of British socialism, to which, with some piquancy, your new ambassador to Washington contributed a chapter, Peter Jay, it is said, it is remarked that by one of the authors, that the trouble with the conservative, with the Tory government, is that they never dared actually set the clock back by 1 minute. His point being that the clock precisely should be set back in some respects. Now, between 1900 and 51, 1964, by what percentage of the GNP did the public sector grow?
Now, steadily, I think, during that time, from 51 to 58, the public sector, as a percentage of GNP, declined.
From 51 to 58?
51 to 58. From 58, it started to rise again slightly. Now, I can't remember, but it finished up in Harold Macmillan's time at about 40%, which isn't bad, bearing in mind that on the basis of that calculation, it's nearly 60%. But in the times when Harold Macmillan, at the end of that period, 59 to 64, was our prime minister, 59 to 63, You remember, he came out with a speech which became famous. The British people have never had it so good. Mm-hmm. Then he went on to say, I ask myself, can it last? Mm-hmm. And it's always one of his proud boasts that at that time, the government sector, national government, local government, and some of our public industries, took only about 40% of the national income. Now, it rose sharply when socialists came in from 1964 to 1970, because again, the public sector went up while the national income did not go up as much. So the proportion taken by the public sector rose.
Because that's more inflexible. Mm-hmm.
In our, yes, it is more difficult to cope with. In our period from 70 to 74, it was, and I just did have occasion to look up the figures, we started with it at 50.6, well, under 51%, and we finished with it as 51.1%. So it only went up by 0.5%
between
1970 and 1974,
and
when we were in. Now, Peter Jay is right, we didn't put it back,
yeah. But
it didn't grow. But then you see the economy was growing. So people's standard of living was growing. Mm-hmm. Since 1974, there's been no growth in the economy. And people's standard of living has declined because they've gone on taking more and more of their incomes to put them into the public sector. Mm-hmm. So I don't regard it as putting the clock back. I regard it as putting the clock forward to where it ought to be to reduce the public sector. You can't do it without some growth.
In your debate at the House of Commons the other day, you made the point that you cannot allocate the whole of a GNP growth to salaries and wages without damaging the accumulation of capital that is required to heighten productivity. Now, is this an argument that you can make on the stumps? Is it an argument that is understood?
No, it's not.
Or do
not
people
understood.
Start screaming at you that you don't understand the problems of...
No, they don't start screaming at one, but you're absolutely right. It's not an argument that has been put, mm-hmm. and it should have been. But you see, the present government has been concentrating now on saying for the last 3 years, or last certainly 2 years, that free collective bargaining means free collective chaos.
Yeah.
And in that case, you mean that the no trade union shop steward is responsible enough in his own factory to negotiate with his own employer. Now, so therefore, people have not been arguing on the basis of personal responsibility at all.
Yeah.
And so they've never argued the economic picture. And so, for the first time, we have had to agree with the International Monetary Fund in order to get the loan that the amount of money in the economy this year would not exceed 13% more than last year. Now, point number one, that 13% still implies a lot of inflation and really should only be a stepping stone to having a very much lesser increase of money for inflation.
But nevertheless, an increase.
But it is, yes, but it is a stepping stone. Now, if of that extra supply of money, up to 13%, all of it is taken out in increased wages and salaries, then there just isn't any left for investment and growth. And this is why we have to say to people, not that you've got 13% to take, but you've got a good deal less to take if you want any growth, and it's only from extra growth that you'll really get extra prosperity. As far as I know, I'm one of the few people who's argued this publicly. The Bank of England in its bulletin has argued similarly, and I have made one speech about it. But you're right, people don't understand. What they do know, and this is why I said you learn by experience, is that although average wages have gone up, oh, enormously in arithmetical terms, something like from about £56 to about £75, the average wages of the ordinary person, over the last 3 years.
It's become meaningless.
Not merely become meaningless, the more they've got happens to buy them less, by some £5 a week, compared with 3 years ago. Now, they know that. To some extent, it's been cushioned by more women going out to work, and therefore you get a higher joint income. But they know, heaven knows, we all feel it. We've had 3 years of declining standard of living. And so they all desperately want more. Now, they will know that if intellectually, that if everyone has more and no one produces more, the extra money will be meaningless. But you know, you don't always think of that when your own particular group is bargaining.
Yeah.
And anyway, if a firm itself produces more, why should its people who work for it not profit from their extra effort and activity?
Well, of course they should. I saw recently an analysis done in the Daily Telegraph based on conversations with three managers of three different type firms, all of them totally frustrated by the problems of dealing with shop stewards, none of whose concerns were with productivity, all of whose concerns were with sort of the cantankerous complaints of individual workers about this side or the other. There was, according to one of them, a total absence of an effective sanction. There isn't anything that you can do to somebody who refuses to cooperate at the margin. As he put it, it was the industrial equivalent of the pill. All kinds of licentiousness can go forward without any dark consequences. Now, here was a situation in which one recalls the arguments that only the Labour Party can deal with the problems of labour unions. And many people who voted rather reluctantly for Mr. Wilson said the Tories can't deal with these problems because they're fraternal problems. Now, do you think that that thesis has been exploded by
Yes, I think it's been exploded. But curious enough, I think it's becoming outdated. Events have overtaken people. To some extent, his analysis had a good deal of truth in it because we have become a low wage, low output society. And the only way to get from that to where we want to be, which is a high wage, high output society, is through negotiations on the factory floor between your management and your unions there. Now, in many, many cases, it is already going on. I have a factory in my own constituency, which I went round just a few months ago. It turns out motor components. And one of the chaps came up to me and he said, when you came round before, 5 years ago, Mrs. Thatcher, I was at a machine over there. It was turning out 1,000 of these parts, something he held in his hand, a day. He said, now I've got a new machine and it's turning out 1,000 an hour. And he was as pleased as punch. Now, all of those negotiations had been done excellently between management and union, and on this basis, they turned and said to them, if we remain an old-fashioned outfit, we'll never be able to compete internationally. Mm-hmm. And if that's the sort of machinery you want in this factory, we can assure you that there'll be no factory here in 5 years.
Well, politics was not involved in that decision, was it?
No. They had excellent relations between management and shop floor. They took time to explain. And most ideas can be explained simply. If they can't be explained simply, it's only because the people concerned don't understand them. So they'd got their increased efficiency. Because they got their increased efficiency, the market expanded and they were taking a larger share of world markets. I happen to cite that. It's a case that I know. It's in my constituency. It's going on in many, many places. But the essence of that was competition. This is the capitalist society. If we don't do it, someone else will. They were in the overseas markets and they knew they'd lose their jobs.
But
now, unfortunately,
it's not working. As you pointed out, they're many more unemployed now than before, in part because of lower productivity.
In part, but you've got to have two things if you want to take up all the extra people. First, when you put in better machinery, you obviously can produce the same amount of goods with fewer people. So your first tranche of investment, in fact, throws people out of work. Now, the difficulty is that this is the stage at which we've often stopped in the last 3 years. We've got some of the first tranche of investment, or even with our existing machinery, we could put up productivity very much more than now. But that stage, and this is why the unions are fearful of it, would be that it would throw people out of work. They've now come to understand that unless they go through that stage, it will throw a lot more people out of work. It's the vital second stage we haven't got to, that you've got to have the growth and expansion in order to take up the extra people. Now, many companies will do it by putting in their productivity deal when they've got a whole unit of expansion going on. I was around another firm in Scotland the other day in the bakery. They'd got all of their machinery and they said, we're going to start that in the next 3 months. We're doing a productivity deal with these chaps. We shall not need to take on any more, but we can draft some of the people from these machines over there. So we have got a difficult interim problem, but at last, I think, people are beginning to realize. Cars is another example. Other nations can land cars in Britain to compete with cars produced here. Overseas, their workers have high wages, but they produce cars at lower cost than ours. It's the same point. It's getting through. It's getting through by experience, aided and lubricated by people explaining.
And what makes you think that a Tory government would do this more effectively than a Labour government, since the channels of communication tend, for historical reasons, to be a little stiffer?
No, I don't think they're stiffer. You see, where it matters is the channels of communication between your management and your shop stewards and unions at the factory or at the place where the bargaining is done. You see, politicians ought not to have got into a lot of this. This has been the mistake. By the time everything's done at the top.
But having got in, you've got to get in, don't you?
I have to get in, but I'm doing very well in by-elections.
There would be some reforms, wouldn't there, that bring on effective sanctions against wildcat strikes, that kind of thing?
I cannot remember any sanctions that have been effective against wildcat strikes. You have the same definition as we do, that a wildcat strike is something that's not approved by the trade union leaders.
That's right.
Yes. That, I must think, your unions will have to deal with themselves. It is a problem, I agree. And I always say that when it comes to negotiating wages between your management and your unions, your management must make their maximum offer to the unions and must not increase it to the militants. Otherwise, they're strengthening the hands of the militants against the hand of your responsible trade unionists. All the time, you're trying to increase the responsibility. But you see, bargaining hasn't been able to take place at that level in phase one and phase two.
But this is a council of despair, isn't it?
No, I'm not despairing.
Do you have specific wage or labor union reform laws of the kind that were backed at least by Mr. Heath?
We had that, and we passed a great big trade union relations reform law in 1970. I think had we had another period in Parliament, a lot of it would have worked. As it was, we didn't get that other period, and I'm afraid a lot of it didn't work. I think if I were to come in putting up that as a new proposition, I think it would put up a target which some of the militants in the unions could shoot at. I think it would be wrong to do that. I think I've got to throw back, and again it fits in with my political creed, the responsibility to them. Our responsibility on productivity bargaining is up to them. There are certain things which we will have to do about the closed shop, about mitigating the effects, some of the adverse
sure,
effects
because
of the closed shop on
people. It isn't
as
though their indulgence affected only themselves. It has a ripple effect on a lot of other people.
Oh, yes, it does. But you know, reality is the most powerful tutor of all, and they've had a pretty good dose of it in the last 2 or 3 years. And what's happened is that everything that we said, and it's not surprising because we were talking common sense, is now coming to be true. And people are realizing that now. And so we really have the tide of opinion with us now.
Why isn't there then a general election about now?
Well, I wish there could be. As you know, we're winning by-elections. You don't have by-elections, do you?
Yes, no, we do.
You
when
do.
People die.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, we're winning by-elections in areas where the Conservative Party has never won and where Labour has held them, and in strong mining areas. The fact is that so long as the Liberals, with their only 13 votes, support the Socialist Prime Minister, then he has a majority, and we can't bring him down in the House. So if they decide not to support him, that could bring about an election.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Thatcher.
It's been a pleasure. I've thoroughly enjoyed it.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. That's Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations. ¶¶